What are we doing here? Are we tearing these or are we just putting blobs on the screen? Come on! Hey everybody, now welcome to Live on Four Legs YouTube channel, and we've been going on. This is the eighth week we've done this, and we're now at the self-titled Avocado record. We've gone through a lot of these, and this record really begins the modern day version of Pearl Jam, where, you know, they were in their 40s during this album, and it's sort of, a lot of people, and me included, like to call this Dad Ed era, where Ed's kind of matured a little bit, he's kind of taking maturer subjects, and there's a lot less of what was on Riot Act, and a lot of the same kind of themes in songs like Marker in the Sand and Worldwide Suicide, but they're kind of showcased in a different manner. They're kind of showcasing more of a pop rock kind of manner here, and it's a little less angry than the previous albums have been, especially Riot Act, which really, and Binaural as well. But we have a ton of songs to sift through today, and before we start on it, in case you're a new listener, in case you're a new viewer, what we do here is, obviously, you see the list at hand here, and we go through it by, at first, we will come up with five for the first tier, and there will be one of the five that will be the S-tier song, and what S-tier stands for is Super Tier Song, and what we do with that song is, at the end, when we covered all of the albums, and not just the albums, but we're going to go through some covers, I believe, we're going to go through some non-album songs, some Christmas singles, we're going to mix in a lot of this stuff to get every aspect of Pearl Jam involved. At the end of this, they will go into a final super tier list, which is going to be the ultimate super tier of Pearl Jam, and we've had seven winners so far, and I think that that's a big standout group. It's going to be hard to top a lot of those, but as you see on this list here, there are a lot of fan favorites. There are a lot of ones I like and love, and you know, we'll just have to see how this one goes about. I have kind of a feeling, but again, I think I can be swayed in a couple directions with this record. Let's talk about the record for a second, and it fits, like I mentioned, it's the first of the true Dad Ed albums, from this to Backspacer to Lightning Bolt and even Gigaton. Avocado is important to me because when I got back into the band, it was 2006, and you know, sit with me on the story for a second, but I actually, my Pearl Jam fandom was put back into play after probably about 3-4 years, and I dove in a little bit at Riot Act, but really the big part of my fandom was within 1998 to 2000, and then as music kind of changed, I changed along with it, and Pearl Jam was no longer popular, and it was no longer kind of making waves and stuff like that, which just happens. But in 2006, I was actually at a Toronto Blue Jays game, and the player, he was the first baseman for the Blue Jays, Lyle Overbay. If you remember that name, he was a little bit of a journeyman. He played for the Brewers, played for the Blue Jays and the Yankees a little bit later. But, you know, solid hitter, you know, 280 hitter kind of deal. And every time he took the plate, Jeremy played. And it had been, you know, quite some time since I really listened to Pearl Jam. I knew the new record came out. I think my dad actually bought it, which I thought it was a little strange. He doesn't really go after new music, but he seemed to always go after Pearl Jam, but nothing ever stuck with him. That was always the thing. He'd have like five Pearl Jam albums, but never knew a song on him. I think he actually likes Nothing Man. That's the one song I can say my dad actually likes. So yes, that kind of sparked something within me to be like, wow, I need to listen to more Pearl Jam. And then that summer, I was working at a place that summer. I was working at a restaurant where I was staying in the apartment above. And obviously, this tour is going on this whole entire summer. And I was actually at my friend's house. If you, for longtime followers of the podcast, you may remember very early on, I did the show before John. I did the show with Matt. And Matt's my best friend since, you know, first grade, kindergarten. And I've known him for so long. And really, the Pearl Jam connection, and it's all his brother Steve's fault, because his brother would come back. He would go out to Europe. He would go out to all these places and just go see the band on so many different stages. And he would come back and just tell amazing stories. He would say, yeah, I was over in Bologna, Italy, and I found Stone in line for a tourist trap and got a picture with Stone. Like, and honestly, if you look at the two side by side, he's got like kind of Coke bottle glasses and so does Stone. Like they look like twins. They really do. It's pretty humorous. But yeah, he comes back from those San Francisco shows that happened at near the end of that tour. And from that conversation, that turned into like, oh, doing three shows in a row, what happened in Mansfield, and kind of explaining the story for that. And I'm thinking to myself, that's incredible, because I always loved going to shows and seeing how bands would, and I would go to shows where I would see a band at one club in the city, and I'd go out to Jersey to see the next band, and they'd have the same exact set list. I'm like, why am I doing this? Why am I going out? And like, I'm expecting something different. But when he told me that, when he specifically told me about Mansfield, my ears perked up. I'm like, whoa, this band does that, huh? That's something I kind of want to be a part of. And I already love the music. I already had, Yield was always a record that I absolutely had the most respect for and loved. But from that point forward, it was just everything in my life was Pearl Jam. But Avocado was, obviously, since it was brand new, it was clearly something that helped get me back into following this. And yeah, I think at the time I loved a lot of these songs. We'll see how time has treated this, because this is interesting. This time period where this album happens is 2006. We were knee deep in the middle of a war, the second term of the presidency that not a lot of us really were on board with, and the band was still pissed, but the band kind of had this sort of feel to them, like, we can be pissed, but we can kind of use our voices to actually sound out instead of just using it for anger and using the anger platform. I think that they wanted to express in a different facet, and there was a lot, you know, Comatose notwithstanding, but there's a lot less angrier songs off this record, so I think we should just get into it. Why don't we just get into it? We should start off with Life Wasted. So, Life Wasted, I think, is one of those songs that I really attached myself to very early on. And as the years kind of went by, you know, hearing it live, good and great. And then it kind of became this song that's just like, after a while, they start down-tuning it, and you're like, well, this is an arena rock song, okay? And Pearl Jam, at this point, was starting to write songs tailored to being arena rock songs. And there's not anything wrong with that, but it just didn't quite feel natural to Pearl Jam as much as the previous records did, where it felt like they were writing these songs for people to listen to in a basement or a garage or even just a club fitting 200 people. And like, this one was way more polished than those records, and well, good. Like, it was hard to keep a lot of them with me up until this point. And that's not a hatred for the record, but it's just where I stand with it today. And Life Wasted, I think, from the standpoint of being one of those songs where it just has absolutely incredible lyrics when you take sort of the vibe of the song out of it. Like, darkness comes in waves, why invite it to stay? Like, that's such a great part, that's such a great aspect to the song. I don't really know where we're going to go with this list. I have an idea for like the tippy top and kind of the songs that follow after, but I can live with the fact of putting Life Wasted in between the first and the second tier. I can live with that for now, and then we'll see where we're at, and we can kind of maneuver things as we go along. I'm okay with where we stand with that. Worldwide Suicide, again, it's kind of in the same boat as Life Wasted. I was just reminded a couple of days ago, like reading an article or reading something, that the song was written as kind of a, you know, as a tribute to Pat Tillman and like kind of like what his story that he went through. And it was a very, look, he was killed by friendly fire. It was a very common story for soldiers at the time, that they were enlisting and they wanted to be part of the war, and then something would happen and they were gone. And those families had to live with that for forever. They have to live with it. And while I think that Riot Act have more songs that kind of fit the emotion of it, Worldwide Suicide, it's almost a little bit sarcastic in a way, like a worldwide like, it's not, you know, it's not about suicide, but it's saying like, oh, they're going off to war and you're killing them. Like, that's, I don't know, it's tough to kind of equate to that. And as for the song goes, they haven't played in years. I know that there's a war going on right now. It hasn't had the staying power. And it had a little bit from that kind of time period until Obama became president, but Yeah, I don't know. This one is actually rare, because I think it's within two or the three. Because I know it at the time it was seen more highly, but you don't really talk, you know, you don't really hear people talk about the song anymore. So I'm a little conflicted, and I think as we go along here, we'll figure our way into what this list is going to look like. But there's a lot of questions that go unanswered here. Comatose. Comatose is one of their fastest songs, and it's one that just, it rips through, it gets you energized, and it's kind of like that Spin the Black Circle, Lucan sort of vibe. And while this song fits that vibe, does it work as well as the Spin the Black Circles, or the Lucans of the world, or even the Whippings? It did. In 2006, it absolutely did. In 2018, it did not. Like, Ed is a master of the song we hear live now. And there are parts of it where that, if it's illegal to be in love, he forgets the lyrics of that. And that whole section, he runs it into it late and he botches the whole thing. But not only that, I have a severe distaste for when Pearl Jam comes out on stage and plays down-tuned songs. It's like the most irritating thing to me. And Life Wasted, going back to it, it's one of those songs that actually has that aspect that I just cringe whenever I hear that live. And Comatose 2, like, I get it. Ed's voice isn't going to reach the same plateau where it did in 2006, where it was first being showcased. And Comatose kind of has the same. But I like the song a little bit more than I lead on to. And I think it's firmly in the second tier. Again, for now, because I don't know how many are actually going to end up. We'll see. We might have to, you know, later on, we might have to kind of reevaluate stuff, so. All right, Severed Hand. This is one I love talking about. It was from very early on. A lot of my early shows, I was getting Severed Hand a lot. And I feel like it was one that kind of went unsuspecting on the album, that kind of started out, like, sort of weird and sort of spacey a little bit. And then it got into the song, but I don't know if I was lost within that, if it took me out of the song when it hits in the big parts, but hearing it live brought a new identity to it, and they actually do that intro a little bit differently if you go back and listen to it, especially after 2006. It's kind of like this sort of like little guitar, kind of strummy sort of thing that you'll hear off Ed's guitar, and man, they can just fucking, they grab so much steam and momentum from this song. And then you get to the middle of the song, Ed will drop the guitar after the intro, pick it back up to kind of supplement when Mike's doing that ripper of a solo. It's very, very good. The song content is great because it's kind of about like a drug trip and seeing dragons at the 304. I said, fuck yeah, like that's such a cool line. There's so many cool aspects about this. It's kind of rare for Pearl Jam to just have a song and let it be a song that isn't really about much, you know, like most of these songs are about like human impact and emotion and dealing with loss and dealing with struggle and stuff like that. But Severed Hand is just like, it's a cool rock song, and it's good to have those songs. And I think it's easily in the first tier here. I think it absolutely deserves it, and I think it's one of the best songs off this record. So, Severed Hand, tier number one. Moving on to Marker in the Sand, this is going to be another one I'm going to have absolutely no idea what to do with it. Another that I really like the song, and my favorite story from it, and this was at my first show, when they got into the song, and they played it, McCready was kind of playing on a different octave a little bit, and it sort of messed the song up at first. And they stop, they're like, okay, let's get McCready, like, let's Mike figure out what you're doing here. And he's kind of, you know, playing with it, and he's kind of, you know, like trying to figure it out the whole way. And then he gets on the mic, I fucked that up. I wrote the song, but I fucked it up. It's just a cute moment, it's just fun. It's always one that I'm gonna remember from, you know, my most vivid memory of my first show. And I hold that in pretty high regard. I think I liked the song for a while, and again, not a record I go back to very frequently at this point. Marker in the Sand is one that I think will stick with me from time to time, and I might not think that I like it as much as I do, but I really do. However, not yet. Not yet. I think it could be part of the discussion. I think it could be part of this discussion, but I don't want to throw it in one or two just yet. I have no idea at this point. We'll see where it goes. Parachutes. As you see, I couldn't find a nice little graphic for it, so it is literally a parachute. So, yeah, it's a love song. It's kind of like, I've always heard the song and kind of felt like, oh, it's kind of like, kind of airy, kind of like you're feeling like you're on clouds, and kind of feels like it could be like sort of a song that you hear on a mobile or something like that. Like, it's kind of lullaby-ish. You know, it's a love song. It's one of their few, and I don't know, I never really attached myself to it. And honestly, once this Earthling record came out and I heard The Haves, I'm kind of like, oh, well, The Haves has really taken bits and pieces from Parachutes, and I wasn't really crazy about Parachutes, and it's not one they go back to and like, oh wow, like Parachutes, that's what was I not seeing in the song? Again, I don't know. I'm gonna stick it in third tier for now, because it's very hard to find people that have like a real attachment to it. I think they love some of the other love songs, like Just Breathe, obviously, and Sirens, and I think they've attached themselves to those songs, but Parachutes, a little bit tougher to get people on board with, I think. Unemployable. It's Ed's version of playing a Bruce Springsteen song. It's very, like, it has that jersey. And on a big pumper stick, say, oh, Jesus. Like, it just has all that. And even though he's not embellishing that as much, you can kind of tell, like, okay, Ed, you're doing your best, Bruce. And you hear, like, the progression of the song, and you're just like, yeah, this is a classic 80s, 90s Springsteen song. There's nothing about it, you know? I don't know. Some of the lyrics are kind of interesting, you know? Like, talking about that portion of individuals. I say that the people that are kind of working blue-collar jobs that really don't, they're middle class. They might be lower middle class, and they don't really have much of a direction. They don't have a college degree. And they lose their job, and like, where do you go from there? You know, while you don't want to admit it, you kind of want to, like, exterior wants to come off as being like rock solid masculinity, but you know, the scared alive, afraid to die, like, that's like, yeah, like, you know, believe it or not, those are feelings that probably go through everybody's head. And it's an interesting song, but not near anything. So, we're a mess right now, but Unemployable's third tier. This is going to be the messiest tier list that we do, I think. You know, maybe we'll have to look at Lightning Bolt and see what that turns into, but this is interesting. So, I think the back half of the record is more inviting to try and figure this out, but Big Wave is another one of those songs I don't know what to do with. I don't know what to do with it at all. Obviously, for most of you who understand the lineage of the podcast and former co-host Matt, who like is obsessed with the song for some strange reason, and then we actually did an episode where we covered it, and he listened to it, and he's like, you know what? That wasn't a very good version of Big Wave. I don't really care about it as much anymore. I thought that, oh, that's a mature take on it. When he would say every episode, Big Wave, Big Wave, Big Wave, and it kind of became a running joke. And now we haven't really talked about the song in forever. And yeah, it's a surf rock song. It's kind of cool, and you know, it has that sort of like, you know, being on the beach mentality. And you know, it's another one of this record that kind of like Severed Hand, where it's not, it's just being a song. It's not trying to be an idea. It's not trying to take a piece of life. It's just like, surfing's fucking fun, and we love this. We love being out in the ocean, and that's always kind of a theme for the band, is that, and especially Ed, that surfing is very important to him, that he uses a lot of ocean analogies. So I don't know with Big Wave. I'm gonna tweener this too, in between second or third tier, because I don't know what the fuck to do with it. What are we doing here? Are we tearing these, or are we just putting blobs on the screen? Come on! Yeah! Alright. Here's where we can have legit conversations. Gone. Great. Always loved the song. Always had an attachment to it. And if you don't know the story, Ed wrote the song while he was in a hotel room in Atlantic City in 2005, where they were doing back-to-back dates in Borgata. Yeah, the next night, he went on and he would play this solo, and it kind of became this kind of folk legend, like, okay, this is a brand new song, where are they going with this? It became a Christmas single, and then it ended up on the record. It ended up being one of the best songs on the record. It just has this drive to it, no pun intended, but it has this drive to it where, again, like Ocean, the car driving songs are such a huge impact on Pearl Jam's story writing, and especially Ed's story writing. He's always like, you know, wanting to get away from a situation, wanting to get away from a scenario. And Gone is certainly, if you want to take the little markers here and say River Mirror is part of it and MFC is part of it, Gone is certainly a part of it too, and a great part of it as well. Like, you know, there's some really just, there's some moments where this soars towards the end and you just feel like a euphoric state from the song, and it gets really exciting. Yeah, I think Gone is a first-tier song. I love it. I think it's phenomenal. Belongs up there. So, finally, we got another in the first tier. Woohoo! Let's see how we do with the other. Wasted Reprise, which is Reprise from Life Wasted, which is usually utilized live when they need a second to talk before a song like Life Wasted, or perhaps a song like Better Man, which they do a lot. And it's the time where, you know, Ed can kind of shout out boom, and Ed can kind of tell a story, or, you know, it's, but, you know, kind of gets on the personal edge, or tells a story about, you know, somebody that he knows that's going through something. You know, it's not much else. I am going to put this in the not applicable category here, because it's just, you know, it's a nice little reprise of what Life Wasted was, and that's cool. It's kind of a transition to get you from Gone into Army Reserve, which the back half of the record is definitely way different from the first half of the record. The first half is like a lot more rockers, and the back half is a lot more kind of like rhythmic and sort of like different. We're going to talk about Army Reserve in a second, where Army Reserve is, you know, has a very different vibe to it, and it's kind of mid-tempo. Some of these are mid-tempo, and yeah, it's a transition. It kind of, you know, takes you to the back end, but I don't see it. It's not a part of anywhere on this list. Army Reserve is very interesting. Another that didn't really stick with me too much then. Doesn't quite hit the mark now. If I hear a good version of it, there's some versions. I want to say Jacksonville in 2016 is a version to go back to, because I feel like they really get to jam on it. They really kind of go all out on this version. They start feeling it in ways that maybe the song was a little bit too stiff before that. And the lyrics are fine. The lyrics are solid. I mean, it could be a two when all is said and done, but, you know, we might as well take care of this now, because we're looking at Life Wasted, Marker in the Sand, Worldwide Suicide. So what's going in here? What's not? I would say that easily Big Wave is in the third tier. That's about the best I can do for now. Whatever doesn't make it here will be in the second, but I don't, again, Worldwide Suicide is way too tough. It defines a certain aspect of the record, and so does Army Reserve, but songs, they don't quite make it until this time. Not that they're bad, but it's, you know, within time, some things age nicely and some things don't quite get there. Comeback and Inside Job. These are going to be quick conversation for phenomenal songs. Comeback, look, we were talking before about songs like Severed Hand and Big Wave, where those songs can just be, you know, fun. That can just be fun. And Comeback is one where you really dig into the emotional aspect. And you kind of dig into, you can kind of see the character that Ed is narrating during this, and, you know, just some of the detail in the lyrics, like wishing that there was a way to find your loved one again. And I think that any time that I've talked to people who have lost loved ones, Comeback has been part of that conversation to help them kind of get through. And it's a very good song for that. It's a very good song in general. And I'll go back to, as I like to do much every episode, I'll go back to a version of this I've seen. Memphis 2014. That night, Ikey Owens who was the keyboard player for Jack White's band, had passed away before the show, and they were playing this one for Jack, and I was on the rail that night. And no other song that night really had this attachment, but I was able to kind of feel the band's sorrow and just all their heart pouring into this, and knowing that, like, they lost a friend, they lost somebody that they really respect, and you were just able to feel all that during the song. And for that, I think that changed my mind about the song, where at first I was like, yeah, okay, I like it, I get what it does, but, you know, now, after that, I got the emotional aspect from it. It's first tier, for sure. Inside Job is going to be first tier, sorry to spoil it, but look, we only have three in there, and I think that it was pretty obvious from where we were going with this that Inside Job would be at the top. Inside Job is, I'm not going to mince words, it's a masterpiece. It's Mike's masterpiece. It's basically, you know, his everything that culminated up until that point, the story of his life and the story of his struggles and sort of what was going on internally with him. You didn't really see, like, especially lyrically, you didn't see any Mike songs at all. You saw kind of Mike take out his frustrations with solos. Mike take out his frustrations with melodies. But this, he tells the story of what he'd been through with addiction, what he'd been through dealing with Crohn's disease and feeling like he doesn't have, you know, like there's no way out of this. And it's another one of these songs lyrically. You know, how I choose to feel is how I am. I will not lose my faith. It's an inside job today. Like, that, I mean, you don't have to have, like, complete mental health struggles for that to attach to you. But when you do, it's all the more special when that happens. And it's just, it's so euphoric. That solo at the end is so euphoric. You kind of, you feel the rise from it. It's a perfect way to end the record. I might come off as I like openers more than I do closers, but Inside Job makes it really tough to say that I don't love closers more, because I think this one enhances the pack. It's in the first tier. Let's clean up some of the mess. All right. Between Army Reserve and Worldwide Suicide, one has got to go in the second, one has got to go in the third. I just don't get enough from Worldwide Suicide anymore to call it a second tier. Now, to people that do, you know, I'm glad that you do, but Army Reserve, I think, is more has some substance to it, and I think it can sneak up at you on you at times. And then we have Life Wasted versus Marker in the Sand. I think I had a few negative things to say about Life Wasted. That I didn't really have many negative things to say about Marker in the Sand, aside from, like, oh, you know, it is not one I pay attention to, but when I do pay attention to it, I end up really enjoying it. So I think for that facet, and like, weigh that along with what the band takes from it, and I think it's one of the few from this record that they have continued to play. And I think that weighs more than my opinion. So I'm going to actually say that Marker in the Sand falls to second tier, and I'm going to move Life Wasted up to the top. And there we have it. Now, look at what we have to deal with here. Life Wasted will obviously stay on the first tier, because if there was that much struggle to put it there to begin with, then it's not going near the S. So Severed Hand, Gone, Come Back, and Inside Job today. Should I make this a long conversation, or should I make it a short conversation? Because I feel like it doesn't even need to be that long. I think there's a very obvious answer here based on everything that I've talked about. But I will kind of go through and, you know, make it my top four. And I'll get rid of one as we go along. And the first one I'm going to get rid of is actually Come Back. And maybe someday it'll, like, have even more of an attachment to it. But I think the other three songs, like, musically, like, Come Back is cool because Come Back has that kind of 50s swing to it. And that's really interesting. Like, you know, if you know the song from Back to the Future that Marty has to play, Earth Angel, it kind of has that feel to it. It has that vibe. So go back and listen to that. Like, that like, it kind of has that same twang. So, yeah, I think musically, I the other three songs are superior to that. I would say that Gone would be the third, and by a very slim margin. Yeah, that's... I don't really have much else off of that, but, like, I like Severed Hand and Inside Job better. And then Severed Hand, it just doesn't beat Inside Job. There's so much about it that just everybody can attach themselves to it. It's a Mike song. And then, look, I didn't even mention this, but after you had Steve Gleason on the song, like, introduce it and say, how I choose to feel is how I am. And then, like, him saying, and how I feel is fucking awesome. Like, how is that not such a motivating moment for that? How do you look at that song and you're like, oh, it's just okay? I don't think anybody can say that. That's why, out of all this, it's the most superior on the list. It is the S-tier song. It's going to go into battle with all the other S-tier songs, which, if you haven't checked out the other episodes, you can. They're all on our YouTube channel, where you can see what was the top song. What was the S-tier song? And this one will have a very tough battle with all the early stuff and all the mid stuff as well. So, we have more to do. But let's do a recap. Waste of Reprise is not applicable because it's not quite a true song. It's just a transition with a little bit of kind of some keyboard melody. Third tier, Parachutes, Unemployable, Big Wave, and Worldwide Suicide. It was very tough to get there. Had a little trouble with Worldwide Suicide and Big Wave, but essentially it all came down to I liked the three that ended up in the second tier more. And it's pretty rare that we have only three in the second tier. Usually we kind of do it the opposite. But that's just kind of how this stuff ended up. And second tier is Comatose, Marker in the Sand, Norman Reserve. And yeah, it was just very tough to decide on. And, you know, again, some of this could be seen as, like, overall. And some of this could be seen as just what this album and the strength of this album, which I do think had some strength. I do think still has a little bit of strength, but I think it's waned a little bit as time has gone on. So what ended up in the first tier, ultimately Life Wasted ended up there because it's a song that the band still sees pretty highly, has great lyrics as well. Severed Hand, Gone, and Come Back. I think that's a pretty solid representation of this album. And then the best representation of this album in the super tier is Inside Job. There you have it. We did it. These are going really quick. These feel like they're going really, really quick. And if you're watching on YouTube, then what you don't know is we're actually recording these two at a time on our Facebook live stream. And you can join the Pearl Jam podcast community group if you want to follow that every Friday night. But yeah, the next one we're going to do is Backspacer, and just ready for more conversation. And look, if you like the channel, subscribe. We post all of our podcast content to this channel, and what we do on the podcast is we take every episode. Every episode is a different live show in the band's catalog, and we'll go through some early stuff. Recently, we went through the 30-year anniversaries from some very important 1992 shows, including Den Hog, and of course, MTV Unplugged, that had to be talked about on the 30th anniversary. And then we'll do stuff, obviously, 1998 and the Yield Tour, and we'll do the Riot Act Tour, which I really love. And we'll kind of, you know, we'll split things up, and we'll kind of go and bounce around. And, you know, we love to do anniversaries and stuff like that. So a lot of errors are covered. And we, look, everybody that tunes in seems to really enjoy it and like the reviews. We go through the history, we go through the set list, we go through some of the unique parts of the songs, and it's really a blast. It's fun to go back to all these shows and really look at it through a critical lens, and I enjoy it. And if you want to support the podcast, first of all, head to liveonfourlegs.com to support our Concertpedia page. And if you're there and you see a little button that says become a patron, then if you want to help out the show, why don't you become a patron? That's all you have to do is donate $1 a month, or you can do $10 for the year. Or if you want to do on the higher tiers, it's $5 a month or $10 a month. And those will get you some specific things like episode requests and personal profile episodes. But everybody on every tier gets the whole entire Patreon catalog, from Evolution episodes where we go through a live the history of a live song and, you know, how it's grown and changed throughout the years. And we'll also do the Bridge School series is done, and that's all in the archives. We'll do other shows. We'll do fan profiles. Everything is there. It's a lot of great content. If you want to check it out, patreon.com/liveandfourlegs, or there's the Patreon app. Search Live and Four Legs. Everybody that's watching in that is a patron, thank you so much. You're probably seeing your name scroll on the side. You guys are unbelievable. Thank you for supporting us. And even for all you watching at home that hasn't pulled the trigger on it, you guys are awesome as well. Like, everything counts here, and, you know, nobody's left behind on this. And, you know, just for watching, just for intaking this content, you guys are helping us out. So hopefully you guys will like it and comment and, you know, spread the word to what we're doing. So, all right, that's all I got to say. Be on the lookout for Backspacer next week. I will be there. Will you? Stay tuned. See you next time.